Good morning, and welcome to First United Methodist Church of LaPorte, Texas. I'm Kevin Gilmore, and I serve as the pastor here, and I'd like to welcome you to this online service of worship on December 19th, 2021. We're so close to Christmas. I want to invite you to join us Christmas Eve night, 5 and 10 p.m., for wonderful Christmas Eve services, communion, candle lighting, singing Silent Night, all of the wonderful things that we look forward to each year. So be here with us Christmas Eve night. I believe that is Friday night, actually. And so I hope you'll join us this week on Friday night. Today we're continuing our Ugly Christmas Sweater series. And I'm not much one for sweaters because, well, it's just too hot in Houston for a sweater. And so I've picked all these lovely Ugly Christmas shirts to wear as a part of this series. We've all had fun with this Ugly Christmas Sweater theme. I hope you've enjoyed it as well. Thanks for joining us.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Please join me in prayer. Our loving Father, we are able to love each other because of the love you first shared with us. You showed great love for us when you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to live in this world. What an awesome and undeserved gift that was. Thank you for loving us. You have made it clear that by loving us, you expect us to, in return, love each other. Forgive us when we falter and fail in that love. Forgive us when we refuse to see the good in others that was put there by you. Forgive us when we hold each other to unfair or too high standards. You have made us each unique in our own way. Thank you for that diversity. Help us learn to love despite our differences. You have also made it clear that we are to love ourselves and we are to love others as if they were ourselves. For those of us who are our own worst critics, please help us to see with eyes that mirror yours. Help us to forgive ourselves as needed. Help us to forgive others as needed. Help us to purge our hearts of anything that doesn't result in hearts full of love. As we come closer to the birth of your son, so many people find themselves in pain or desperate circumstances. Please hear now our personal concerns, both spoken and written on our hearts. And now, in honor of the ultimate love you bestowed on us, we pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem. Because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.
Today we are finishing up our Ugly Christmas Sweater Advent series. The Advent part, anyway. So far, you can continue wearing your Ugly Christmas Sweaters as long as you want to. So far, thanks to Donna, Charlene, and Doug in person worship, and with me in online worship, we have wrestled with all of the ways we often live with ugly thoughts, ugly words, and ugly motives. Today we want to take a look at the ugly actions that we often choose. During all seasons, we have to be mindful of our actions. But Christmas is a season when we can make conscious decisions to bless people because of the blessing that God has given us by sending Jesus to earth. We have the ability to live like Jesus. But often, we end up acting like an ugly old Christmas sweater. Let's pray. And now, God, may your word be proclaimed, either through me or in spite of me. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, it's at Christmas that when it's Christmas time, when we often see all at one time the best of humanity and the worst of humanity. For the weeks leading up to Christmas, we join the rest of the world pushing and shoving and fighting for the newest iPhone, the latest gaming system, the fanciest jewelry, or the hottest toy doll, and arguing over all kinds of things. Whose house are we going to go to, and all those things. And then we turn around on Christmas Eve, and for an hour, we celebrate the birth of our Savior. And we talk about peace on earth in a dimly lit room with candles, singing Holy Silent Night. Now, how can these two extremes happen all at once? Well, the Bible tells us that we have two natures constantly warring against one another. One nature inspires us to love people around us and to live humbly, while the other nature causes us to want to look out for ourselves first while pushing others down. This battle begins when we are very young, and unfortunately, it does not get any easier as we grow older. But by the grace of God and by God's Spirit living inside of us, we can grow to treat others the way God would treat them. The Apostle Paul wrote the book of Colossians as a letter to the people living in Colossae. The Colossians are a lot like you and me in that they were a group of people who were trying to figure out what it looked like to love people well in the light of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Somehow, in some way, the sacrifice of Christ should have a profound impact on us as followers of Jesus. If not, we never make the shift from being ugly Christmas sweaters to something more beautiful. It's time for our ugly actions to become godly actions. The season of Advent is meant to be a time for us to slow down and to reflect on the reality of Christ's birth and the reality of his return. We need to allow these two truths to change us, to move us to become individuals who love one another well. This season reminds us of a few very important things. And the first is that people do crazy things in the name of Christmas. If you drive down my street at any point starting in mid-November, I'm sure many other streets just like it, there are massive blow-up figurines from Santa to reindeer to Star Wars figure to the Grinch. Those things are not cheap either. We put up these massive trees with beautiful ornaments and spend thousands on the best decorations, parties, and gifts. Something about this time of year causes people to reorient their lives around the holidays. Normally, rational human beings will cover their homes in lights, buy way too many gifts, and all kinds of other Christmas craziness. Schedules change, attitudes change, budgets change. Why? Well, it's Christmas. As Paul is writing to the Colossians, he is making a plea for the followers of God to reorient their lives in a different kind of way, to be willing to live in unique and countercultural ways because of the ways of God, because of the love of God. Paul is very persuasive in telling his audience that there can be no more excuses for not living life God's way. He expects it. He says it this way in chapter 3.
Verse 17, "And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him."
After a long discussion, which we'll unpack in just a minute, Paul shares his final thoughts with his readers. Everything we do in life, everything whether in word or deed, needs to be done in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. How much of our life? All of it. Everything. All of our lives should be lived in the name of Jesus. So how are you doing with this? If you were to look back over the last month, how much of your life was lived based on your relationship with Jesus? What percentage of your words and your deeds were centered on Christ? More often than not, our actions do not look like Jesus. And they can sometimes be selfish, they can sometimes be self-serving. We talked about that last week. Paul tells us to make sure our actions are reflective of the fact that we are grateful for God's grace in our lives. When we give thanks for all that God has already given us, then we are more ready to treat others with love and respect, all in the name of Jesus. The kind of intention it takes to wear a great outfit to a party is the same kind of intention it takes to live as God's people. You don't just wake up each day with godly actions instead of ugly ones. It is a choice. Living the way Paul tells us to live is a lot like choosing a Christmas sweater. No matter what kind of, I mean, that's the next thing that I would say for us today. We pick our own sweaters. No matter what kind of crazy sweater someone chooses to wear, they picked it. Paul writes to the Colossians and gives them this insight for the kinds of actions that their lives exemplify.
Verse 12, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience."
The Greek word used here for clothe or put on is the word enduo. Enduo literally means to sink into a garment or to cover yourself in it. This is an active word that Paul is using to paint a picture for his readers. For us to love people well and to not act like an ugly Christmas sweater, we must intentionally put on or sink into new and better kinds of actions. The kind of intention it takes to pick out a great Christmas Eve worship outfit or Christmas morning pajama set is the same kind of intention it takes to live as God's people. You don't just wake up each day with godly actions and avoid ugly actions. We make the decision each and every day of how we will treat others. How we treat our spouses is important. How we treat our children is important. How we treat our friends is important. Paul lists out what kinds of actions the Spirit requires of us. First, he says, clothe yourselves with
compassion.
Compassion is the ability to see a situation from someone else's vantage point, to feel what someone else is feeling. Compassion is what leads people to serve others, to give sacrificially. Compassion is the key to changing a broken world. This takes selfless attitudes. And then it results in people actually listening to one another. Paul tells us to clothe ourselves with
kindness.
You know, kindness sounds like a simple word, but it is a much harder word to actually live out. Kindness is what happens when we are always looking for practical ways to serve one another. Mowing a neighbor's yard, buying groceries for a family under a financial strain, writing a letter just because you want to encourage and bless someone. Kindness is saying the right thing at just the right time or taking action when you're in a position to make a difference. Kindness is doing the right thing to positively impact those around you. Kindness is what so many of you have shown to us over the past few weeks. Paul tells us to clothe ourselves with
humility.
Now, humility is not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking about yourself less. Humility is taking on the kind of mentality Jesus taught us and modeled for us. Selfishness is ugly and is the basis of all sinful action. Humility, then, is the way in which sin is overcome and the way of Jesus is made a reality. Paul tells us to clothe ourselves with
gentleness.
Now, this comes from a word meaning controlled strength. Gentleness is not about weakness. It is about power. This power comes from the Spirit of God living in us, and it helps us control our impulses. In gentleness, our actions express themselves in service to the weak and the powerless among us. Now, this is not a word that describes a wimp. This is a word that describes someone who is not afraid to step into injustice or brokenness to institute change. Paul tells us to clothe ourselves with
patience.
Patience here can also be translated as long-suffering. It means to tolerate something for a long time before getting angry or before giving up. Clothing yourself in patience allows you to love people who are hard to love and to serve people who are hard to serve. Patience is the key to becoming someone who looks like Jesus, because spiritual maturity does not happen overnight. None of these attributes come naturally to us. We must choose them and we must put them on. We must sink into them. We have to clothe ourselves with them.
So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving each other, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity.
Have you ever had an ugly Christmas sweater that you just absolutely loved? Maybe you wear it every year. It is your go-to ugly Christmas sweater for all of the parties, all the gatherings. But then one day you snag a thread in it, and it starts to kind of stick out and unravel, and it's threatening to pull apart. You carefully try to pull it back in or snip it off or tie it, only to find that if you pull it anymore, the whole sweater could possibly come unraveled. This is a dangerous moment, and the moment we realize that it is all connected. Every thread is part of another thread. The same is true for the Christian. All the things that Paul says in these verses, they all have a common thread. And that thread is love. He says, above all else, put on and clothe yourselves in
love.
This action gives life to every other action. Without love, all the other attitudes unravel and mean nothing. The Christmas season is all about a God who loved us enough to send his own son to save us. Therefore, it makes sense that love would be the binding attribute for us to love others with godly actions. To really love others, we have to put love into action. Moving from ugly actions to godly actions starts with love. The word Paul uses here for love in our Colossians passage is a very specific word. It is the Greek word agape, which means sacrificial love. Agape is a love that will cost us something. And the question is, are we willing to pay the cost to live with love? We cannot just say we love people. We must show we love people through our actions. If we're going to live with love this Christmas season, it must start with God's love. We must first realize that God truly loves us.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him.
God himself was motivated by love. This love prompted Jesus to come to us. God did not send Jesus to come and condemn the world. God sent Jesus to rescue it. Every action Jesus takes throughout his life, throughout his ministry, even his death and resurrection, is based upon a love for all of humankind. We have the incredible, incredible opportunity to love people around us. In loving others, we make God evident to a world who cannot see him. The mark of a Christian is someone who is dedicated to embracing God's amazing love and allowing this love to overflow out into the world. Love is action. This Christmas season, this week, I want to challenge all of us to choose one person, to choose one family, to choose one group of people, choose whoever you want to offer sacrificial love to put on compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness and patience in the way that we treat them. Maybe a stranger, maybe a neighbor, maybe a brother or sister. Let's pray together. God, help us. Help us move from ugly actions to godly actions. God, help us to clothe ourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, but most of all, God, clothe us with love. Help us to put love into action this Christmas. In the name of the Holy One, who came to us at Christmas, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
We believe that God has come to us, that God brought us into being, that we have been blessed to be a blessing to others, that we have fallen short of this commandment, but that God has nevertheless loved us despite our brokenness. We believe that God is coming to us, that God is not happy to leave us alone, that God will be made known to us in flesh and bone, that Mary will soon give birth to a son, that Jesus Christ will be born and our salvation made complete. We believe that God will come to us, that God will have the final word and that word will be good, that the day is coming when tears and pain will be no more, and all will gather at the table to sing an endless and perfect hallelujah.
Thank you.
Thanks again for joining us on this Sunday morning. Reminder again, Christmas Eve, 5 p.m. and 11 p.m. For Christmas Eve worship. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forever. Amen.